Right, so welcome everyone. Thank you for joining us. So today for the second talk in this classical and quantum gravity series, we have Karim Nouhi, who will tell us about classification of scalar tensor theories and applications to cosmology and astrophysics.
So yeah, thank you very much, Mark, and thank you very much, Etera, for inviting me in this series of seminar. It's too bad that I see you only in two dimensions, but hopefully at some point we can meet and see each other physically. As Mark just said, I'm going to talk about a classification of scalar tensor theories, which is a work I've been working on the last, let's say, 5-6 years, mainly with David Langlois. So this concerns classical gravity more than quantum gravity. I'd like also to underline that I worked with many different researchers in the scalar tensor community. So you can see some names here. Please, this is not quantum gravity, but if you want to stop me to have more details and things like this, don't hesitate to stop me. And I would be happy to give more details. So let's start with a very broad introduction. Something that you know very well. But I like this introduction because this is the only slide where I'm going to talk about quantum gravity just a bit. So as you all know, general relativity is a very successful theory for the theoretical aspects and also for observational and experimental aspects, as the detection of gravitational waves again showed a few years ago. But there is the questions whether general relativity, as it is written now, is the ultimate theory of space-time. We know that we have problems with the description of very short distances and the problem of singularities, Big Bang singularities, black hole singularities, and as you know, maybe much more than me, all these singularities are maybe the sign of the breakdown of the theory and the sign of the fact that we may need a quantization of the theory. But we know also we have more classical problems with general relativity, or at least open issues related to general relativity, one of these being the problem of dark matter. So is it a new particle that we have not found, which is still unknown, or is it a modification of gravity? As you know, there are some models of modified gravity that account for dark matter. These models are today strongly constrained and not very viable, to what I know, but there are still interesting proposals. And also there is this problem of the acceleration of the expansion of the universe. So the problem at the large scale of the universe, what is the reason why the universe is expanding? Of course, we have the solution of the cosmological constant, but as you know, cosmological constant, this solution has also some problems, we have some troubles with it, and this is the reason why we try to find alternatives to the cosmological constants to explain the accelerated expansion of the universe. So these are one of the motivations why we are looking for modification of gravity. But I'd like to just before showing the overview, I'd like just to underline that my motivation is not really, I mean, of course, I'm interested in the problem of the dark energy and the acceleration of the expansion of the universe. But this is, even though this is one of my motivation, it's not my main motivation. I think the main motivation for me to modify gravity is to test general relativity, because maybe the best way to test the limits of general relativity is to try to modify it, to find some, let's say, test of general relativity that we can see in the sky somewhere, and then to see, and also to say to the experimentalist what kind of deviation one should expect to see. And so one of the applications, of course, of modified gravity is dark energy, but not only. And at the moment, I'm working quite a lot on quasi-normal modes, and I'm trying to see how these modifications of gravity can also help understanding deviations of quasi-normal modes compared to general relativity. So the overview of the talk will be the following. So as again, we are interested in modification of gravity, maybe at large scale. So this is what I'm going to talk today, even if this is not my main motivation. I'd like to, in the first part, to show you how many models of scalar tensor theories, which are the simplest modification of gravity one can think about, how these models has appeared in the they have appeared in the literature. And I see you, I will try to show you that the last 20 years there were a huge activity in this domain, and a huge activity that led from the very first model of interesting, let's say, scalar tensor theory for dark energy, to this classification that we have proposed with David Langlois a few years ago. And if I have some time at the end of the talk, I will give you also some physical applications of these dust theories and of these scalar tensor theories concerning cosmology. So of course, how these scalar tensor theories apply to explain or to give an explanation of dark energy. And also I will give you some very interesting applications to astrophysics. So before starting, the guideline of the talk is to present really the state of the art of this domain, which is really active. And I will mainly focus on the construction of the theories and on the properties, let's say the theoretical properties of these theories. I'd like to show you how we came to the construction and to the classification of these theories. And then, as I just said, in the third part, I will nonetheless try to quickly illustrate these theories with the physical applications that I've just talked about. And also, I will give you also some ideas that we have and new directions that we want to follow in the future. So now, a bit more about the motivations. What makes general relativity beautiful is certainly the fact that it is unique. And as you all know, unicity of general relativity can be illustrated very well with the Lovelock theorem. And we know that if we assume that space-time is four-dimensional and it comes with is diffeomorphism with the symmetries, which are diffeomorphisms, if we assume that gravity is described by a metric only, so a spin 2 tensor, and if we ask that Euler-Lagrange equations are second order, so we cannot escape the Lovelock theorem, which states that the only possibility for us is to have Einstein gravity plus a cosmological constant. Okay? So it seems that from such very well-known theorems, there is no much room available for alternative theories. Not only gravity and general relativity is beautiful because of this unicity theorem, but also we know that very well general relativity has passed all tests that with flying colors, and the last ones being the detection of gravitational waves. And we all know that the waves that we have detected are in total agreement with all the calculations up to very large order that are predicted by general relativity. So why we nonetheless look for modifications of gravity? So I'd like to show you to motivate the reason why we want to modify gravity is a very nice cartoon drawn by Claudia Doran, where you can show that where you can see where general relativity has been tested. In the space of systems, so in the x-axis you have the mass of the system, in the y-axis you have the size of the system, and if you look carefully to the systems where general relativity has been tested, roughly it has been tested in this region where we are here. This is the size of the Earth, the solar system. You know that the blue line corresponds to systems where you are in the quantum regime, so the size of the system is smaller than the quantum length. In the green part here, you are inside the black hole, so you have a very compact object. So the only place where so far we have really tested general relativity is the yellow part. So in the very large scale, at the size of the universe, and also in many other places of this diagram, we see that we have not tested general relativity. So for this reason, it is clear that we can expect at some point that we may have a deviation from general relativity. So even though general relativity has been tested and it is in total agreement with all the tests that we have done so far, we may expect some deviations at some point. And the problem is that when we start to relax one of the hypotheses of the Lovelock theorem, now everything starts being very, very complicated. So I have also taken this graph, I mean, this nice slide from Tessa Baker, where she illustrates that if you start with general relativity, you modify it by relaxing one of the hypotheses of Lovelock, then you get a landscape which is very, very large, and a landscape which is very, very complicated. For instance, if you add new field, so you are in this part here of the graph, if you add a scalar field, for instance, you have many, many models. And you can see that if you assume that you have higher order terms, like this kind of Lagrangian, if you have non-local theories with this kind of operators that appear in the Lagrangian, then higher dimensions and so on and so forth, you have a landscape which is completely, I mean, very, very rich. So what I'm going to talk about concerns mainly this part here. And even in this part, where you add a scalar field in addition to the tensor metric, in addition to the metric to modify the general relativity, the principle of general relativity, even in that region, things are quite complicated. And what we managed to do with David Langlois was to clarify the landscape, and this is what I'm going to explain you today. So, modify gravity. What we want to do is considering scalar tensor theories, which means that, as I've just said, we add a scalar field in addition to the metric. If you want to use scalar tensor theory to account for dark energy, somehow this scalar field, which will be responsible for the fifth force that is responsible for the expansion, for the acceleration of the expansion of the universe. But in general, we can classify scalar tensor theory without having in mind only the problem of dark energy. In itself, the problem is quite interesting. So we want to relax the second hypothesis of Lovelock, stating that metric is the gravity is only described in terms of the metric, so we have an extra field. And also, as you are going to see, we are also going to relax the conditions that the equations are second order. But this second condition will come naturally in the constructions, you are going to see. So the motivations are manifold for doing that. First of all, adding a scalar is, of course, the simplest situation. If you want to add a new field starting with a scalar is certainly the less complicated case. And also, it is interesting because even if you add more complicated stuff, in addition to the metric. For instance, if you consider a massive graviton instead of a massless one, if you consider big gravity theories or vector tensor theories or even extra dimensions, you can notice that in most of these theories, there is a scalar propagating in addition to the other fields. So even in these situations, you have a scalar mode. And you can isolate the scalar mode using a limit which is somehow, sometimes called the decoupling limit. So in this limit, you have a scalar tensor theory. And also, concerning the second point here, the equations are not necessarily second order. Why? Because if you look carefully at the Einstein-Hilbert action, you know that Einstein-Hilbert action is written in terms of the Ricci tensor. And the Ricci tensor involves, of course, second derivative of the metric that you know very well. Even though you have second derivative of the metric in the action, you still have second order equations of motions for the Einstein equations, which is not completely obvious. I mean, it is obvious because you know Einstein equations very well. But if you think about the fact that you have a Lagrangian with second derivatives, but still equation of motions are second derivative, this is something which is unusual. The reason why it works in general relativity will become clear in a few minutes. So now, if you can also mimic what happens for general relativity with the extra scalar fields. So you can start having higher second order derivative of the scalar field in the action, exactly as you have second derivative of the metric in the action. So in that situation, you may expect to have equations of motions which are up to fourth order in the scalar field. So this is the reason why we are going to relax the condition that the equation of motion are necessarily second order. But I will come back to this because it's one of the key points of the construction. And so with these ideas, there have been a lot of scalar tensor theories that have been constructed in the last 20 years. Why the last 20 years? Because we discovered the expansion of the acceleration of the expansion of the universe in 1998-99. So since people, they were trying to find alternative to the cosmological constant to explain this acceleration of the expansion. And this is the reason why we have seen a lot of different proposals in the literature. So the first part of my talk will be really to show you most of these models that appeared in the literature, from the Brunswicki model to those theories. So let's start with the beginning and with the simplest situation. The first traditional scalar tensor theories that have been introduced to understand some aspects of general relativity are these Brunswicki theories, which are just scalar tensors, very traditional ones, in the sense that you see you have here the Ricci scalar, the capital R, and you add a field phi that evolve according to a Lagrangian, which is a traditional one. X is the name that I'm going to give to this guy, which is just the kinetic density of the scalar field. Okay, so X is just d mu phi, d nu phi. Phi mu, for me, is the derivative in the direction mu of the scalar field. So these are very well known. They have been studied quite a lot since they were discovered in the 60s. And there were first generalization of the Brunswicki theories, which is known as K-essence. Maybe you heard about this theories. This K-essence theories is a simple generalization of Brunswicki in the sense that instead of having the Ricci scalar times a function of phi in front of R, instead of having this linear function of the kinetic energy, you have an arbitrary function of the scalar field and of phi mu, like this one. So this is known as K-essence. This was the first proposal, and these theories were studied very a lot because the phenomenology of these theories is really interesting. One of the nice features of having Brunswicki or K-essence is that you can allow now for non-minimal coupling to external fields. So in general relativity, when you have a field psi, let's assume that psi is a scalar field, then usually you couple psi to general relativity in a minimal way, which means that you consider this g mu nu phi nu, psi nu, for the Lagrangian. But the fact that you have a scalar field living in a theory means that you can add in front of this guy a functions, a coupling constant that depends on the scalar field itself. So this introduces a non-minimal coupling, and in general, it will lead to violation of the equivalence principle. So this is quite interesting because you can test, of course, these violations, and this kind of coupling have been very severely constrained by observations so far. But really, one of the main motivations of, I think, Brunswicki theories was to introduce this new type of coupling. But in general, as you can see, this kind of theory is not dramatically different from what you know from in usual quantum field theory or in usual field theory. One novelty appeared in the 2000, in 2000 as well. And this novelty, which is important, is concerned second order scalar tensor theory or the DGP model. In fact, in the context of a brain cosmology, and I don't want to explain the context in details, I'm not sure that I can explain in details what the construction of the DGP model. So this guy, Dvali, Gabadadze, and Porati, so they show that, in fact, it is possible to introduce a new type of field theory which involves second derivative of the scalar field. One typical example is this guy here. So now, just to be precise, so previously in Brunswicki, we had only this kind of term, which is a a mass, a Planck mass, which depends on phi, times the Ricci scalar. Then K essence comes with this general function that we call G2. And now let's introduce this G3 function. And you see in the Lagrangian, you have second derivative of the scalar field that comes with this box phi. So this is a new thing. In fact, such theories in the field theory and in general relativity had never been considered before. And the reason why is that usually when you have second derivative of a field in the action, in the action, you get higher order equation of motions, and higher order equation of motions leads to trouble in general. But here we can show that even if you consider this guy, which is called the cubic Galilean for some reasons, the equations of motion are still second order. So this is quite interesting. And also, what makes this model very popular, which is known as the DGP model or as the cubic Galilean, what makes this model, this theory very popular, is the fact that it has very interesting late time cosmology properties. In other words, you have a very nice scenario to explain the acceleration of the expansion of the universe. To illustrate this point, we can consider a simplest example. So you see, here I'm just taking a subclass of the general class here. So I'm just assuming that G2 is just x, and G3 is x as well. And of course, this new term here comes with a coupling constant, and the coupling constant, I call it lambda, just for dimensional reasons. So this lambda has a dimension, this is necessary just to put a hierarchy between the different scales of the different terms. You can show that if you look at the solutions of these actions, there is a self-accelerating solution without the need of a cosmological constant. But at this stage, you can say that, okay, you have no cosmological constant, but you have more complicated stuff in the scenario. So this is not really interesting. But I will show you why this is still very interesting. But for the moment, just forget about it. And you can show that if you look at the cosmology of this theory, you have self-acceleration. And if you want this self-acceleration to be compatible with what we observe today, you need to have a lambda here, which scales like this, where H0 is the Hubble constant today, and MP is the Planck mass. So we can fix the scale of lambda with the self-acceleration. What is very interesting in this theory is that you have a Weinstein screening mechanism, which is one of the key ingredients of this scalar tensor theories. What Weinstein screening means? This screening is the property that ensures that you have these theories modify general relativity as very large scale, because what we want a modification of general relativity at the cosmological scales to account for dark energy. But of course, we want to recover the usual general relativity equations at short scales, at the scale of the solar system, for instance. And indeed, what you can show is that there is, because of the non-linearity of this term, you see here x contains 2 phi, and you have a phi in addition, so you have phi to the cube in this term, so this is a non-linear term. Because of the non-linearity of the cubic Galilean, there is a Weinstein radius in this theory, which is the following. So this RV, which is the Weinstein radius, tells you that if you are in a scale which is much larger than RV, so you have a modification of general relativity, for instance, self-acceleration. But inside the radius, if you have the distances which are smaller than RV, then you recover exactly general relativity, and everything is compatible with the Einstein equations, which is exactly what we want. And this screening, this radius here, this Weinstein radius, is different from one star to another star. So if you want to compute the Weinstein radius with for the solar, for instance, in our solar system, if we consider just the Weinstein radius associated to the solar, then we can show that RV, so the distance where the effect of the modification of gravity becomes important is very, very large. So you are safe, general relativity is still valid at the scale of the solar system. And this mechanism, the Weinstein screening mechanism, is really important. And this makes one of, I mean, this is one of the reasons why people were very, very interested in this series. So now if we go a bit further, so people, they introduced this cubic ion, so there were a lot of activities in that. And then a few years later, so these people, Nicolis, Ratazzi, and Tricchirini, they also, they have written a very famous paper called Galileo, Theories of Galileo, where they showed again that you can extend a bit more the landscape of theories which involve higher order derivatives. So now they introduce this kind of Lagrangian here, where you recover here the K-Eastern term, you have the cubic Galilean that has these very interesting properties of self-acceleration and screening, but also they notice that you can also have terms which are quadratic in the second derivative. Okay, so this guy is linear in the second derivative of phi, and this guy here, this guy is, these two guys are quadratic in the second derivative. And they classified all these guys up to terms which are cubic in second derivatives. And in this theory, gravity is not dynamical in the sense that you see, this is just the theory of a scalar. They introduce these theories in some context, so I don't want to recall. And what is interesting is that in these theories, you have higher order terms in the Lagrangian, but still equation of motion are second order. Again, this property is very similar to the property of the cubic Galilean, and you can show that you have very similar properties like screening and self-acceleration if you add a metric in the scenario. And this is exactly what these people, De Fayet and collaborators, did 10 years ago. In fact, they started with the theories of Nicolis, Ratazzi, and Trinchirini, the theories of Galileo. As I said, this theory is a theory of a scalar field only, and they made the metric dynamical. So they coupled everything to a metric, and they found what is known as now Ordensky series. And what is interesting in this history is that, in fact, they have rediscovered a classification that has been done by Ordensky a very, very long time ago. Ordensky, I have already talked about this in a conference, but Ordensky, I think he was a student of Lovelock, who asked him to find all the scalar tensor theories that produces second-order equations for the metric and for the scalar. And this is exactly what does this action here. Okay, so there were classification up to terms which are cubic in the second derivative, and this action here produces equations of motions which are still second order in the metric and in the scalar field. So people were very happy with that, and as I already showed you, so there were huge interest the last 10 years on Ordensky theories. So I have already shown this graph where you can see that the work of Ordensky that has been totally ignored since the discovery of Galilean, so from 65 to 2010, almost no citations, but since you had a lot of activities with a lot of citations. And so I have updated this plot, and I added this graph here, which is also very interesting because you can see this graph here is exactly the same as this one, but it is focused between 2008 and 2020 and today. And what is interesting is this number here, 50,000, which is the numbers of papers that are citing the paper of Ordensky. You see, so it's just a second order term, and so it is even more impressive. So you see that this number, I think, is a nice illustration of the big, huge activities on Ordensky theories the last 10 years. So I don't know what is going to happen in the from now, but this activity was very, very important, and it is still really, really important. So let me now continue a bit the history of the classifications of these higher of these higher order theories. As I said, the starting point was really the discovery of the acceleration of the expansion of the universe, and then we wanted to find alternatives to the cosmological constant to explain this. So step by step, we constructed this K-Essence cubic Galilean, now Ordensky. And so after the rediscovery of the Ordensky theory, there were this general belief that we found the most general, viable, and interesting scalar tensor theories. Of course, more general in some frame. What is interesting also with this theory is that it provides a very interesting parametrization of modifications of general relativity. Not only these modifications are interesting for the problem of dark energy, but it can also be interesting for many other things, for many other properties that to test the limit of GR in the infrared, so in the large scales, but also this kind of theories can be appeared to test some aspect of the theory in the ultraviolet, so some quantum aspects as well. So having a very general parametrization, which is consistent, is really interesting for all these aspects. The fact that we have now an arena to play with the modifications of general relativity to compute new effects that we can test with experiments in order to, again, test general relativity and also to constrain this new theories here. Concerning the problem of dark energy, these theories are very interesting because, as I said, they have self-acceleration without cosmological constant. There is this screening mechanism, but also one point that I'm not going to talk about in details is the fact that you can find solutions which are self-tuned. Self-tuning means that you can add a bare cosmological constant in the Lagrangian, which is, let's say, the vacuum energy in QFT. You start with a cosmological constant, and you can show that in these theories, even if you add by hand a cosmological constant, there is a self-tuning mechanism that gives you a solution where the final cosmological constant is zero, whatever the initial one is. So this is the reason why you have this kind of self-tuning. So you can solve the problem of one of the problems of the cosmological constant, which is why we don't see the vacuum energy, why we don't see it in the sky. And in these theories, you can show that you can hide completely these cosmological constants thanks to this self-tuning mechanism. So this is one of the reasons also why these theories are so interesting and so important. The problem is that people also were very excited with this new class of scalar tensor theories, but then came some surprises because you see in 2014, the construction of new theories appeared. We show that, I mean, these people, Gleize, Langlois, Piazza, and Vernizzi, they show that there exist new viable theories which are outside the Ordensky class, which means that maybe we don't have the largest class and maybe we are missing something important in this classification of Ordensky. And also new examples came in the scenario, like the well-known mimetic models by Shamsedin and Mukhanov, which is written here. So this is also a theory which is a modification of general relativity that has been introduced mainly to account for dark matter, not dark energy, but it is still a theory which seems to be totally fine. And this is not included it contains higher derivatives, but it is not included in Ordensky theories. And many other theories appeared, like Lorentz breaking theories, which some of them are named chronometric theories. Also some models of Orava gravity, Cusketon. We had a landscape that was becoming more and more complicated, and it was quite difficult to understand what was going on in this with these new theories. And here, so what we did with David Langlois, so this is one of the main results that we had, and then I will explain you how we proceed for the construction. So what we managed to do is to classify all these higher order theories. So we found the most general viable scalar tensor theories with Lagrangian that contain up to second order derivatives of the scalar field. So far this is very similar to what Ordensky did, but what we realize, and which is quite a simple realization, but this is not very complicated, realize that the equation of motion are not necessarily second order, and they don't need to be second order. And this is, I think, the key point to understand the classifications of all these theories. So equation of motions are not necessarily second order to have one scalar propagating in addition to the 2 degrees of freedoms, which are the 2 gravitons of general relativity. So this is the work that we have done with David Langlois in 2015. So now the picture is this one. So the green area here corresponds to the usual Brunswick-Dickey theories. Then Ordensky came, and we had this class of theories, which contains qubit Galilean and all the Ordensky Lagrangians. So then we had what we call the beyond Ordensky theories that appeared, and that were they were discovered by Gleize, Langlois, Piazza, and Bernoulli. And what we say is that in fact we can put all these theories into a same big class, which is called now DOST for degenerate higher order scalar tensor theory. I will tell you why we call it degenerate. It will become clear in a few minutes. And what we claim is that if there is no, this is the most general theory, and if you are not in the DOST class, then you are propagating an extra degree of freedom in the theory, and this extra degree of freedom is a ghost, which makes all theories in this pink part here not physically viable. Okay, so now what I would like to show you after all this historical introduction is the construct. I would like to explain you how we constructed these DOST theories, starting with a very simple toy model. So maybe some of you knows very well this kind of model, because I have already talked about this in some seminars. So to understand the classification of DOST, let's start with a very simple situation. So now we are in classical mechanics, and we have a particle phi of t, which dynamics is governed by this action. So here you recognize the usual harmonic oscillator, and you add a term which is a higher derivative. Okay, so phi double dot square. Why square? Because if it's not a square, this is a total derivative, and you can eliminate these terms by integration by part. Now look at the equations of motion. Of course, this guy produces the usual harmonic oscillator, and this term here produces a fourth order derivative of phi. So now we have the structure of the equations are very different from the usual one, because this fourth order derivative implies that we need 4 initial conditions. Okay, so these 4 initial conditions here to integrate the equation, and hence, as you have 4 conditions, 4 is 2 times 2, you have 2 degrees of freedom propagating in the theory. So in fact, in this theory, you have 2 degrees of freedom propagating. To see,
sorry, Karim, can I ask you, Karim?
Yes,
can
okay.
I ask you a stupid question? What if you need to specify phi, phi dot, and phi 2 dots? Then how many degrees of freedom? It's like 1.5.
Yeah, that's a very good question, Sergei. Thanks a lot. I will give you an example like this one, where you have only third derivative. But I think you have to be careful, because when you have an equation where you only have when you only need phi dot and phi double dot, you have to be very careful to analyze the theory. But I will show you an example exactly like this one in a few minutes if you want to wait a bit.
Okay.
So now, what is wrong with this theory? Why having 2 particles is problematic? In fact, there is a theorem, which is called now Ostrogradsky theorem or Ostrogradsky ghost, that I'm going to illustrate here, that shows you that indeed this extra degrees of freedom is problematic. In fact, you have an equivalent action, an action which is equivalent to the previous one. So instead of having this, let's consider this action. Okay, so now we have 2 fields, phi and psi, and you see here, if you look at the equation for psi, and then you substitute the solution for psi back to this action, you get exactly the previous one. So this action here is totally equivalent classically to the previous one, completely the same. What happens is that this action, so now you see clearly that you have 2 degrees of freedom because you have phi and psi, and each of them comes with its kinetic term, psi dot, phi dot, and so on. Of course, the kinetic term, the phi dot square and the phi dot psi dot, you can combine them and to write, you can write them in that way. Oh, sorry, there is a phi. You can write them like this, so you see. And you have one kinetic term, which is phi dot plus alpha psi dot square, minus this term here, and there is no alpha. I don't know why the alpha should be alpha square. So sorry, here there is a typo. This is alpha square and not alpha, which means that this guy is positive, this guy is negative, so the energy of the system is necessarily unbounded from above and from below, because the energy can be as big as you want in the positive sense and in the negative sense. So this extra degree of freedom is a ghost. There is an instability. And this is the reason why when you have second derivative of the scalar field in the Lagrangian, you have this problem. I have illustrated this theorem in a very simple situation where the theory is free, so everything is linear. But you have a general theorem stating that if you start with a Lagrangian like this one, with a second derivative of phi, you can write the Lagrangian in a way, in this way, so using a Lagrange multiplier. And what you can show is that in this situation, it is very easy to show that the Hamiltonian contains a part which is linear in one of the momentum in the phase space. And so as the Hamiltonian is linear in pi here, the Hamiltonian is not bounded neither from above nor from below. So you have what is called the linear instability. So in general, Ostrogradsky ghost is often associated to what people call linear instability. And linear instability comes from the fact that the Hamiltonian is linearly unbounded. This is what this formula is saying here. So this extra degrees of freedom indeed is problematic. So now, just to we can elaborate a bit more with this toy model, and then I will go back to the question of Sergei. So now assume that instead of having one scalar, 1 degree of freedom, you have 2 particles propagating, phi and q. So here you recognize the same one, the dynamics of the field of the previous one. You add a standard harmonic oscillator, this q term here, so you see, and you have a derivative coupling. So phi and q are coupled with this funny coupling here. Now, if you look at the equations of motion, you see that this equation involves up to the fourth order derivative of phi, third order of q. So, and this one, you see, so this is a good illustration of what Sergei was asking. You have third order derivative of phi and second of q. So the question we can ask is the question that Sergei asked: how many degrees of freedom I have in this theory? How many initial conditions I need? In fact, it's not easy. It's not easy to count, and it's not easy to guess how many degrees of freedom we need to integrate this equation. And in fact, in general, what you can show is that such theory propagates 3 degrees of freedom. So you need 6 initial conditions to integrate them. 1 degree of freedom corresponds to the phi, 1 to the q, and the third one is the ghost, the Ostrogradsky ghost that shows up in this situation. But something is happening here. In fact, I have chosen this example with this funny coupling because if you work with not small q but capital Q, and you define capital Q like this, you can show that this action here is exactly the same as this one. And this one does not contain any higher derivative anymore. Capital X should be small q. So sorry, there is a typo here as well. So you see, in fact, it seems that in this theory, you need 6 initial conditions, and then it seems that you have 3 degrees of freedom. But if you look carefully, you in fact have only 2 degrees of freedom, which means that you need only 4 degrees of freedom, 4 initial conditions. So it's not easy to guess from the shape of the equations how many initial condition units and how many degrees of freedom are propagating. So what kind of, and yeah, so the property that you can absorb the higher derivatives in a redefinition of the variable, this property is called the degeneracy. I mean, is an illustration of the degeneracy. And this is one of the key aspects of, I mean, this is the key aspect, I mean, the key property to understand the construction of ghost theories. So now, before elaborating a bit more on this model, let's just take some lessons from what we learned with this toy model. So the first lesson is that we can ask the question, what is the meaning of recurring second order equation of motions? So there were this implicit idea that to avoid Ostrogski instability, you need just second order equation of motion. And in fact, this is the reason why Lovelock classified theories of general relativity with only second order equations of motion. And again, Ostrogski showed us that if you consider higher order terms in the Lagrangian and higher order equations of motion, it seems that you get into trouble. But the situation is not so clear, as we saw when we had two particles. So there were this belief that having higher than two order than order two earlier Lagrangian equations necessarily leads to Ostrogski instability. But of course, you know very well that even if you have equation of motions that are the earlier Lagrangian equations which are higher order, this doesn't mean that you cannot extract from them second order equation of motion. So in other words, the earlier Lagrange procedure to get equation of motion from a Lagrangian give you one set of equations, but these equations are not necessarily minimal in the sense that they are not necessarily the ones that come with the lower order, lower number of derivatives of the field. So this is something that we have to keep in mind. And indeed, there is one property that came that appeared very important, which is this degeneracy. In some cases, degenerate actions, in fact, we can absorb higher derivatives into our definition of variables, and this is possible only if you have several variables. Okay, so with only one phi, this was impossible, but with phi and q, this was possible. The problem is that how can we guess the change of variables? Because I gave you an example which is a free theory, the Lagrangian is quadratic, but this argument should exist also for non-linear theories where you have a Lagrangian which is like general relativity. And the only possibility that we found to understand this aspect is to make a Hamiltonian analysis. And this analysis will give you exactly the tools to understand how many degrees of freedom you have in the theory and how you can evade the Ostrogski instability. And of course, once we understand this, we can adapt all this construction to scalar tensor theories where you have a scalar and a tensor. So you are exactly in the situations where you have two guys, one scalar, one tensor. So you can expect the same situation to happen in the sense that if you have higher derivatives of the scalar field, maybe you can reabsorb it into our definition of the metric. So Karim, Sergei?
To find which theories are degenerate, can you maybe act in the opposite way, namely start with the general theory with second derivative equations of motion and just do a generic change of variables, and in this way produce the most general degenerate theory with higher derivatives?
Yes, that's a good point. So we studied this in details in some reference that I can give you in details for classical mechanics, and in fact it's not as direct as you said. So in the sense that in the example I gave, it is clear that I agree with you. You can absorb second derivatives thanks to a redefinition of variable. But this is not always the case. In fact, you have some situations where you can never reabsorb the higher derivatives thanks to a redefinition of variable. There are some situations as well where you cannot find an implicit change of variable where you can do that. And in some cases, the change of variable is not even local. So you see, in fact, if you do like you want to do, Sergei, maybe you will construct one, you will have one class of higher order derivative, but you will miss many of them. And you are going to see this is exactly what happens for scalar tensor theories, because you can, if we follow your idea, which is I think a very natural and very good idea, you can do the same thing for scalar tensor. We know today that Ordensky theories is the one that produces second order equations of motions, and there is no ghost. And you can imagine a general change of variables that produces, I mean, all those theories. This is true. You can do that. But if you do that, you are missing some theories. So you see, it's not, I wanted just to illustrate the degeneracy with this example, but you cannot reach all them just with a change of variables.
Okay.
So now just let's continue.
Let's elaborate. In the action you showed in two slides before, I think that the sign of the potential terms are negative, right? So isn't it a problem? I mean, there is no stable vacuum for this theory. Is it correct or no?
No, you mean so here the potential is okay. You see?
No, the bottom, the.
This one? Oh.
Yes.
No. So you see here, phi comes with this minus omega, which is okay, and this one it seems fine, because you see you have a kinetic term minus a potential.
Ah, okay.
The potential is
as well. Yeah. Okay.
But what you are raising, I think it's interesting, because of course you're totally right in the sense that here I'm giving ingredients to cure the Ostrogasky instability, but you can still have other kind of instabilities like these ones. So if you have one potential which is not bounded from above, you can also have in cosmology gradient instabilities and many, many other types of instabilities. So I totally agree with you that when you evade the Ostrogasky instability, this is not the end of the story, because you have to ensure that you have not no other type of instabilities.
Thank you.
But I will maybe come back to this a bit, okay. Bit later. So I think I have to accelerate a bit. So as I said, Hamiltonian analysis is maybe the best way to understand all this aspect. So let's quickly return to the toy model. I will just elaborate a bit more on it. And now I consider this general action here, which is a very trivial generalization of what I showed you before. So you still have the phi term, phi dot square, then you have a potential for phi, you have the q dot square, which is here, and you have these higher derivative terms here. Okay, so if you want, this is very similar to what I've shown you before, but a bit more general, because you have some constants, a, k naught, kb, that appears in the scenario, and which makes the theory much interesting. So you see, the Euler-Lagrange equation, so the general ones, this one that generalizes the one that I showed you before, v phi and vq are the derivative of v with respect to phi and to q. Again, fourth order in phi, and this one is third order in phi. You have third order derivative of q and so on. So you can ask again the number of degrees of freedom. And you can have a system which is up to fourth order, third order, and also second order. Okay, so this is just a generalization of what I showed you before. Now, how do we perform the analysis? We don't like having higher derivatives in the Lagrangian to do Hamiltonian analysis. So what we do, we use a Lagrange multiplier, pi, here, and this Lagrange multiplier allows you to define a new variable q, which is phi dot. So you, if you want, you eliminate the phi dot, introducing the velocity that you call q. So everywhere where you have phi dot, you replace it by capital Q. So the phi dot, so the phi double dot square term is this one. Okay, so you eliminate higher derivatives, but the price to pay is adding new variables, which are this one. So just something very, very simple. At this stage, you can make Hamiltonian analysis. So Q comes with its momentum. Same thing for small q, phi and pi are conjugate, because you see in the Lagrangian you have phi, pi, phi dot, and then in general 3 degrees of freedom. So as I said, in these theories, you have 3 degrees of freedom. One of them is a ghost. Now, of course, to compute the Hamiltonian, you need to invert the relation between the velocities, q dot, capital Q dot and small q dot, in terms of the momenta. And you see that there is a relation between the momenta and the velocities, And this relation is given by a matrix here, which is called the kinetic matrix. So it's just you take the Lagrangian and you compute derivatives of the Lagrangian with respect to the velocities. So P is related to the velocities like this. Now, what happens? It happens that if this matrix is invertible, which is generically the case, then there is no constraints in the theory, and you have 3 degrees of freedom, and one of them is a ghost. You can show that. If kin is invertible, you can show that the Hamiltonian still has this linear instability. So you have one ghost. But when the kinetic matrix is degenerate, in that case, you can go further into the Hamiltonian analysis. You can show that there is a constraint, which a primary constraint, there is in general a secondary constraint, there are some conditions for that. And so you have at least 2 constraints in the theory, and these 2 constraints are sufficient to kill the Ostrogothic ghost. So there is no more Ostrogothic ghost in the theory, in these degenerate theories. In fact, I'm a bit too fast here. There are some assumptions behind, but roughly this is what is happening. So you need degeneracy, you need constraints to kill the extra degrees of freedom. But even in that case, earlier Lagrange equations are second order. In that simple example, as Sergei explained, you can reduce, because the theory is free, these higher order equations, you can write them in terms of second order equations only. But this is not always the case. Now, maybe can I take 5 more minutes, Mark, just to tell you something about scalar tensor theories?
Yes, sure. Go ahead, please.
So I will not have time to give you some applications to them, but let me just tell you how the construction works, because if you understood these toy models, then you understood everything. Because now you want to do the same thing with scalar tensor theories. Namely, you start with an action like this one. So now you have the Ricci scalar of the metric multiplied by a function of phi and x. I remember that x is the phi mu term. And you add all possible terms which are quadratic in the second derivatives. Of course, you can consider terms which are cubic and higher orders, and everything works in the same way, even if it is more complicated technically. Let's just illustrate with this kind of term. Thanks to the covariance, which is really important, these terms are not, I mean, there are not much quadratic terms like this in the Lagrangian. The only possibilities are these 5 guys. So you have a term which is phi mu nu, box phi square, and this funny combination, which are all quadratic in the second derivative of the scalar field. Okay? And here you have 3 functions, alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3. And then you have an action which involves higher derivative of the scalar field. In general, you have a ghost. And in general, you can show indeed in these theories, you have 2 tensors propagating, so which are the gravitational degrees of freedom, and you have 1 scalar, which is the phi scalar, and 1 companion, which is the ghost. In general, you have this. And as I've told you, what you can do is making Hamiltonian analysis. So you proceed exactly as you do when you make the Hamiltonian analysis of general relativity. You introduce the ADM decomposition for the metric. You have also a kind of ADM decomposition for the scalar field. Just don't be, I will be very quick with the details. But at the end of the day, you have a kinetic matrix which relates the momenta of the theory with the velocities in the theory. And you have a kinetic matrix like this one, which is now 7-dimensional. Why 7-dimensional? Because we have 1 dimension for the scalar field, and 6 dimensions because of the 6 components of the spatial metric. I can skip the details, but then what you can do is just at this stage saying that if I want to avoid the ghost, I need to find the conditions for the kinetic matrix to be degenerate. I compute the determinant, and the determinant give me some conditions for for the degeneracy condition. And that's it. At the beginning, I started with three functions, alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, and f here. So I have these three functions in the scenario, in the model. And at the end, I'm just asking that I impose degeneracy. And I found several conditions involving the functions alpha, f, and so on. So at this stage, you can say, okay, this is very complicated. How can I solve these equations? In fact, these equations are all algebraic. So you can find the conditions that the alphas, the functions, need to satisfy for degeneracy. You can do that. And maybe let me just, let me just finish with this slide because I'm running out of time. So you can solve these conditions and you find two types of solutions, type one and type two. Type one solution is very interesting because you can show that all solutions which are degenerate in a type one, they are related to Ordensky theories by a change of variables. So this is exactly what Sergei was suggesting. We have this Ordensky theory, we make a change, a general change of variables, and we get all the type one theories. But there is another type, another class of theories that we call type two. And this type two are not related to Ordensky by a redefinition. But interestingly, we can show that physically they are not viable in the sense that we have eliminated the Ostrogothic ghost. But as Ali said previously, we have to be careful with the other types of instabilities. And we can show that all these type two, they have necessarily new instabilities in them. So the only viable possible theories are, at the end of the day, this one, which are related to Ordensky. And maybe, so there is these situations. What I'd like to say, so so maybe I can stop here. So I'm very sorry that I don't have any time to tell you about the applications, but if some of you want to discuss a bit more after the end of the seminar, I'm okay with that. And let's go to the conclusion. Up this one. And so just to conclude, what I showed you is that we managed to give a systematic classification and a full classification of those theories that do not propagate any ghosts. They are very interesting and appealing applications to cosmology. And this application to cosmology allows us to constrain, to compare the predictions that we have with observations, and we have very strong and severe constraints on the free parameters that we have introduced in these theories. And that's it. So I will stop here. Thank you.
All right. Thanks, Karim, for the nice talk. So maybe we can take a few more questions if there are more questions.
Karim, I have a question.
Can I? Yes.
Mark? Yeah. I was wondering if degeneracy that you described, since it's represented by a constraint in the Hamiltonian formalism, is it similar to a gauge invariance of a theory?
Ah, that's a good point. In general, it's not, because degeneracy is in most general situations associated to second class constraints. So you see, degeneracy in the Hamiltonian framework means that you have second class constraints, and as you know, second class constraints are not directly associated to symmetries and to gauge invariance of the theory. But in some cases, yes, so you can have also situations where the degeneracy is associated to a gauge invariance. And this happens, for instance, for these mimetic theories that I discussed just a bit in the talk. In these mimetic theories, you have a degeneracy, and this degeneracy is linked to a conformal invariance of the theory. So sometimes it happens, but in general, it is not the case, I think.
Okay. And I had a second question. Are these theories interesting in only in the infrared regime, or are they to be taken seriously also in the UV regime? Are we supposed to study their randomization and properties and so on? Or?
Yeah, very good, Itara. Thanks for the question. In fact, yes, these theories, they have been considered in the UV for several reasons. The first reason is that you heard about this Orava-Lipschitz theories of general relativity, which are Lorentz breaking theories. Lorentz breaking is the sense that you consider theories of general relativity where only 3D diffeomorphism is where you don't have the time reparametrization anymore. So you only have these guys, these 3D invariants, and this gives to the theory, in some cases, very nice renormalization properties. And in fact, many of these Orava-Lipschitz theories, they belong to those theories. Or saying differently, you see here, in fact, we have a scalar tensor theory, which means that we have this scalar in addition to the metric. This scalar, phi, gives you, in fact, a time. In the sense that, imagine that you have a solution where phi is exactly t. In fact, it's possible to have such solutions. So if you take phi and you assume that phi is equal to t, then you have a theory which is effectively invariant under 3D diffeomorphisms only, because you broke the reparametrization event. You fix the time. So these theories, they are intimately linked to diff invariant theories. So in that sense, they are related to Orava-Lipschitz. So in that context, they were used, and some properties, UV properties were studied. But unfortunately, but these degeneracy conditions, I think, is broken when you start looking at loop corrections. So even if you start, you say that, okay, I consider these theories as effective theories at low scale, then if you start computing quantum corrections, then immediately you will be out of the degeneracy, because you have no symmetry to protect this kind of degeneracy, and then you are no more in the class when you consider quantum corrections.
Thanks.
And this is the reason why myself I have not really worked on this UV stuff, because I think this kind of theories for me is interesting as an effective theory for it is an infrared for me effective theory, and not really interesting for UV, but maybe it is, I don't know.
Okay, thanks, Karim.
Can you explain what is written at the bottom of this slide?
This thing here?
Yeah.
Yeah, this is very interesting. I mean, we have posted a paper, the last paper concerned this. So what we showed that, as I said, type one, which is the most interesting theories, they are related to Ordensky by redefinitions of the metric. The redefinition of the metric, the general redefinition, are called disformal transformation in that context. Disformal transformations were introduced by Bekenstein in another context, maybe in the 90s. I don't remember when exactly. So when you have a scalar field, you can naturally have a redefinition of the metric. Let me tell you how. You see, imagine that you start with a metric G mu, then you can define a new metric G tilde like this, which is just proportional to G plus a term which contains phi mu, phi nu. This part is a conformal transformation. Imagine that D is zero. So here it is just a conformal transformation of the metric. And this D is called disformal because you have a disformal transformation. Anyway, so in this type one, whatever, if you consider a theory in the type one, you can always find a transformation like this that sends you to Hordensky Lagrangian, which is nice, but still a bit complicated. What we found very recently is that, in fact, any type one theories is disformally related to this very simple action. What is this action? So it means that you can find a transformation of the metric such that Ordensky and any of these theories can be written as the standard Ricci tensor, the four-dimensional one, plus a function times a three-dimensional Ricci scalar. And this 3D Ricci scalar is precisely what we talk about with Etera. It is the scalar of the surface where phi is constant. So in fact, in these theories, you see precisely why scalar tensor theory are intimately related to Lorentz breaking theories. And this is a nice formulation. So that's quite interesting. So you see, at the end of the day, the theory that is valid physically is just the four-dimensional Ricci plus lambda times the 3D Ricci. And the 3D Ricci, again, is the Ricci on the surface where the scalar field is constant, which is quite
interesting. The 4D invariant, this section?
This section is 4D, yes, it's 4D invariant. But if you fix phi to be T, for instance, of course, it is 4D invariant, but somehow it is kind of artificial because you know that any 3D invariant theory, you can make it 4D invariant using what is called this Stueckelberg field. You can always, when you start with a 3D invariant theories, make it 4D, adding new fields. Somehow, this theory is constructed like this. We start with a 3D diff invariant, and we add scalar field, which restore the four-dimensional invariance. So you can view it as a 3D invariant if you fix phi, or as a 4D invariant, but in that case, you can interpret phi as a Stueckelberg field. So yeah, all this is equivalent.
And yeah, I also have a question, Karim.
Yes,
Mark. As you explained, the way in which you study this degeneracy condition is via Hamiltonian analysis, and it has to do with the structure of the constraints, in particular second-class constraints. But also, so as you know, of course, usually the structure of the constraints of a theory depends a lot on which variables you choose and which Lagrangian you start from. So have people thought about maybe choosing different sets of variables that simplify a priori the structure of these constraints so that everything becomes simpler?
Yes, so that's a very good point. In fact, myself, I tried and I never found a new good way to parameterize the theory. But I think I agree with you. There should exist some parameterization of the theory which trivialize everything. But I don't know. I still don't know what is the easiest, what are the most natural variables to simplify the thing. But I agree with you. Maybe there is one possibility. Maybe not.
Because it seems like the theory is always begging for new field redefinitions. That
yes. So I'm thinking about this, but so far I didn't find any solution to this problem. But I agree with you. Somehow I think with this formulation we are in the point where imagine that you are discovering general relativity, and you write R in terms of the metric. So the metric in terms of the metric. So the Ricci scalar is a very complicated function of the metric that involves second derivative of G mu nu and so on. Imagine that you write R like, I mean, the big formula with which involves the metric only. So what is nice with Einstein-Hilbert is that this big formula that involves second derivative of the metric and an inverse of metric and so on has a nice interpretation of being the Ricci scalar, so which makes the theory very, very nice, and we can do many things. I think in these theories, we are in the point where we have the actions in terms of phi, which involve second derivatives, but I'm kind of convinced that there should exist a geometrical interpretation of these ugly things in terms of something like this. And maybe finding new variables, as you are suggesting now, could help us understanding the geometry behind all this ugly stuff. Because at the end of the day, you see, the general, formulation of DOST is given like this, and the functions A1, A2, A3, A4, I mean, they are quite complicated functions. And maybe one way to find the good variables would be to understand what is the geometry behind this. Or maybe if we find the good variables, we will find a nice geometrical picture or interpretation of this. But I don't know. Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
Can I ask a short question?
Yes, of course.
So in this viable theory, what is the mass of the scalar mode?
Ah, that's a good question. I mean, the mass is hidden in the coefficients that you have here. If you want to define a mass, the best way maybe is to look at the perturbations about one solution. For instance, assume that you have a cosmology. So you have a cosmological background that I can show you here. Yeah. If you assume that you have a cosmological background, okay, and you look at the perturbations of the scalar the perturbation about this background, then what you can show is that perturbations, which are tiny, you have the scalar perturbation that I call zeta here, and the usual tensor perturbation. And you see, the scalar perturbation comes with a potential, and the potential here contains a mass B. And this B is a quite complicated expression in terms of the functions A1, A2, A3, and so on. So this is one possibility to see what is the mass of these guys.
And can it be zero? And can we have massless?
I think, yes, very good. Yes, it can be zero. And if I remember well, so I talk about this mimetic gravity again. Mimetic gravity is equivalent to general relativity plus dust. So it is really dust, cosmological, I mean, a perfect fluid. So in that sense, you have no mass. You are just, the scalar field represent just dust with sound speed zero, and so no mass somehow. So it is possible to have this situation. And this situation is quite interesting. Yeah. It was
quite a lot. I'm a bit confused. I'm looking for a massless particle which is propagating with the speed of light.
No. I sorry. So I think it might be possible. So I don't know. We have to look at, if I show you these coefficients, probably it is possible to tune them in such a way that you have something massless. But I didn't look at it carefully. Yeah. But I think in principle it is possible. But if you do it in practice, maybe you will get it in trouble. So I don't know. We have to check.
Okay. Thank you.
And as I am in this slide, one particularity also of these theories is that gravitons, they do not propagate at the speed of light. And maybe you heard about this, of course, the fact that we found that gravitational waves propagate at the speed of light, so C is almost one in natural units, this has very, very strong constraints on those theories. But this is another discussion that unfortunately I didn't have time to talk about.
But alpha t is necessarily not zero in all these theories. You cannot also.
It is. You see here, to have alpha t to be zero, you need A1 to be zero, because if A1 is zero, G4, you have one here, so it's okay. And you cannot have A1 zero in Hordensky theories. So Hordensky is totally dead, killed by this constraint. But this constraint has been discussed really a lot in literature. So it's not. So I can tell you a lot about this constraint. But if you take it seriously, then Hordensky is no more compatible with this observation. But you still have a lot of those theories valid. Okay. The problem is that these constraints, if you look, these theories here, I mean, the theories of DOST, they have a regime of validity. As I said to Etera previously, for me, these theories are effective theories in the infrared. In fact, from the point of view of quantum field theory, you can show that when you reach a scale which is big enough in energy, this theory, the quantum correlations are no more negligible, and you need to consider them. So you have a regime of validity of these theories from the point of view of the UV completion. And what you can show is that if you compare the regime of validity of this theory with the energy of the gravitational waves that we are measuring with LIGO, they coincide. This means that gravitational waves, they are probing a scale which is in the limit of the validity of these theories. So in that sense, it means that maybe with the gravitational waves, we are probing a regime which is not valid at all with this dust theory. So these constraints may not be relevant at all. And there is a huge discussion about this aspect in the literature. So you see, so maybe this is not important, in fact.
Okay. All right, so if there are no further questions.
Just a tiny question. I was wondering about the TVS theories of the relativistic version for MOND.
Yes.
How do they fit in this dust classification?
Yeah, I was always a bit scared by TVS, which are here, you see, this guy here. These are really, really complicated. So TVS, just for people who don't know, this is, yes, as you said, a covalentization of MOND. So MOND has been introduced by Milgrom in the 80s, I guess, to account for dark matter. So this is a modification of Newton's laws, essentially. And Bekenstein and who else, I don't remember, they found a general relativity version of MOND, which is very complicated. And TVS means tensor, vector, scalar. So there is one tensor, one vector, one scalar propagating in this theory. So maybe if you find they may exist a limit where you have only, where the vector is becomes trivial, where you have scalar tensor, and this might be related or not to dust, but I cannot say more. It's a bit complicated. Now, if you look at the TVS action, it's quite involved. So this might be a good question. In fact, I know maybe someone has looked at it, but I cannot answer concretely to this. Yeah.
Okay. Thanks.
All right, so no more questions. Okay, in this case, well, I thank you for joining us, and I thank Karim again. And I think we will have our next talk in 3 weeks because there is a holiday break here. So we'll see you in 3 weeks. Thanks, Karim.
Who is the next one? Mark, maybe you have a
Next speaker will be Daniel Grumiller.
Okay, so thank you very much to all of you. So I hope to see you, as I said in the beginning,